Black hole sun, won't you come? Wash away the rain. Black hole sun, won't you come? Won't you come? Won't you come?
Gun control. This word means a lot of things to a lot of different people. The history of legislation with the intention of limiting or setting legal parameters surrounding firearms goes back to the dawn of firearms, and that's the subject of today's video. Gun control, when looked at statistically, shows violent crime rates are not affected by gun control efforts of any kind, and that logically, it is more sound to have a more free system of firearms ownership and procurement for the well-being of the populace. First, we need to describe gun control. Gun control is any piece of legislation that limits the ownership, procurement, transfer, handling, and accessorizing of firearms. These laws are typically made with the intention of preventing violent crimes before they happen. Gun control can be as minute as a background check to see if the individual purchasing the firearm has any criminal history, or as invasive as the prohibition of firearms entirely. In the United States, efforts have been made towards every kind of gun control. Some politicians and a small percentage of the population wishes for complete disarmament of the private sector. Others wish for more middling legislation, like magazine capacity prohibitions, assault weapon bans, registries, mandatory universal background checks, safe storage laws, etc. A majority of citizens wishes for things like background checks and safe storage. In a similar minority to a complete banishment, there are some who wish for no legislative efforts to be made at all. Let's first address some important numbers that the CDC and FBI have compiled for us. To start off, 4/5 of gun crimes, as in crimes perpetrated by suspects using firearms, are carried out with illegally possessed firearms. This means that the person in possession of the firearm had committed a crime by simply having it. They didn't obtain it in a legal fashion, or are legally barred from ownership of a firearm. This means that around 80% of gun crimes that happen, laws cannot and will not prevent because they forego the laws to begin with. Secondly, the CDC reports that there are 800,000 plus defensive uses of a firearm each year. This means that crimes were either prevented from occurring or were stopped by a private citizen using a firearm. Compare that to the CDC stats of gun-related deaths, there are around 30,000 deaths resulting from firearm injuries each year. This number is often used without the full story, so it can be quite misleading. 60% of those deaths are self-inflicted. That means that about 16,000 deaths are actually murders and accidental deaths. 2,000 of that 16,000 are accidental. There are, in any given year, 14,000 gun-related homicides. According to the National Institute of Justice, from 1980 to 2008, the percentage of total firearm homicides that were gang-related went from 70% to 92%. This means that only about 10 to 30% of gun homicides happen to people uninvolved with a gang or other crime syndicate. Basically, it's very rare that a completely innocent person is shot and killed in a homicide in the United States of America. What is common, though, is that a law-abiding citizen draws or uses their weapon to prevent or stop an occurring crime. Even more stunning is that there are over 80 million confirmed gun owners. The real number of gun owners is actually unknown, but estimates range from 100 to 130 million Americans. For easier math, we'll use the confirmed 80 million. Using this number, though, we'll find that even if all 14,000 homicides were committed by legal gun owners, only 0.0001% of legal gun owners would ever kill someone. The number, when accounting for gangs, is even more enlightening. 0.00004%. This is still assuming all of those guns are legal. The real number of legal gun owners, the people affected the most by gun control, who commit a homicide with a firearm, is unknown. according to my math, it must be around 3,500 a year. How do laws play a role in this? Truthfully, they haven't at all thus far. All of the laws that have ever been passed have shown to change almost nothing in any of these statistics. The current trends keep moving at their projected directions regardless of legislation. While a complete prohibition of arms has shown to be effective in reducing the gun crime of small European nations, it hasn't done much to change their violent crime or property crime rates, which remain moving at their current trends. Switzerland, which has nearly as many privately owned guns as the US, with a fraction of the populace, has one of the lowest violent crime rates in the world. While it appears that prohibitions prevent gun crime, they don't change violent crime at all. Criminals simply move to different means. This is just what the numbers show you. This doesn't even begin to touch the actual individual effects of gun control. Over the years, it's gotten more difficult for a law-abiding person to obtain firearms, as well as illegal for them to own certain firearms. It hasn't gotten more difficult for illegal possession, though. It's actually gotten easier. Firearms can now be constructed using untraceable parts and 3D printers. Even making the parts illegal or subject to certain legislation will not stop the construction of these guns, as a complete functioning firearm can be constructed from your garage. For more information, look into the FGC9. This means that the only people affected by gun control are innocent people who wish to do no harm, since presumably and statistically, bad actors will choose less legal ways of obtaining firearms. So let's put it this way. Why should an innocent person be barred from owning a firearm, certain accessories, have to wait, or be subject to any other kind of malicious legislation? For instance, me. At this point in my life, I travel with my girlfriend an awful lot, and late at night. Truthfully, this stresses me a little sometimes. I live in one of the highest crime cities in the US. I would preferably be concealed carrying a firearm with me for my girlfriend's and my protection. But thanks to gun legislation, I'm not old enough to, and I will not be able to conceal carry the firearm until I pass certain arbitrary certification tests to get a license. I'm not permitted to legally open carry my firearm either. Why should I, an innocent person who wishes to protect himself, be subject to such laws? If I were a criminal, I would simply go purchase one illegally and conceal carry it anyways. This isn't difficult to do. I'd imagine I could do this within the week if I so wished. I don't, though. That's the issue here. I would prefer to abide by the law, as I don't think the risk of being detained is worth the bonus of protection. That's a sad decision that millions of people have to make each year. This is only the surface of this issue as well. There are economic impacts. Millions of people are employed by the firearms industry. The skills for manufacturing and designing firearms are specialized for it, meaning that they don't transfer into other markets very well. Gun legislation puts these people at risk of unemployment or having less lucrative employment. It will take money out of the economy and affect the welfare state poorly. There's also cultural impacts. Everyone is aware of people in the US who will not give up their firearms. Gun legislation actually has the potential to spark a civil war or revolution, the ramifications of which are scary. Supply lines will shut down, leaving people hungry. Power plants will shut down as workers can't get in due to fighting. Water lines will be damaged, poisoning the supply, billions of dollars worth of damage will be done to private property and infrastructure, and the massive losses of life on both sides of the conflict will be devastating to the families of those lost, and will prevent us from rebuilding as strong as we were. Gun culture in the US is not something to be poked at. Best to let sleeping dogs lie and all that. But what about the people who don't even care about protection, like sporting? They would also be affected, as guns they use for sport are limited or banned. The capabilities of their sport are limited. For instance, 30-round magazines are used for sport, If these magazines get limited to 10, a sportsman may have to either shoot less targets, which is less fun and less entertaining, or have to reload more, slowing their times significantly, which will become frustrating. Limiting the features of their rifles, like taking away a pistol grip, will make the shooter less comfortable for extended periods of time. Taking away muzzle devices may prevent them from attaching ear-saving suppressors that keep them from losing their hearing. It will also prevent them from dampening the recoil of their gun, making it more dangerous. A lot of times, guns are bought by farmers for the purpose of killing vermin. That's why the AR-15 is often referred to as the varmint rifle. The bullet it fires, the 5.56x45mm NATO, or the 223, is a .22 caliber cartridge with fairly weak ballistic capabilities compared to other cartridges. This means the thing isn't that strong. The effective range is about 150 yards or meters, and the energy released into the target is also fairly tame relative to other intermediate to full-size cartridges. This makes it a phenomenal varmint gun. It will hit the critter, kill it, and not over-penetrate, or make too much of a mess. A good clean kill on a potentially destructive nuisance. Things like feral hogs, groundhogs, and other rodents are killed with this rifle. Funnily though, this is the one that is being targeted as the worst of the lot. Worse yet, it's statistically one of the least used rifles in gun crime. Things like the Glock 19 and S&W Model 10 are the most used in homicides. Rifles of all kinds, including bolt-action, semi-autos, anything, make up less than 200 of gun homicides a year. But I digress. These guns have legitimate uses and functions in our society. Limiting them has done us no good and has negative effects on our society. You start to run into an issue with banning guns. And it's that essentially, you are stripping the people of a nation of the right to protect themselves. See, because the principle of gun control is to limit the armament capabilities of the private sector for their own benefit, this means that arms in general will be controlled eventually. The state or government will then be the only thing capable of protecting you from threats, especially as it pertains to women who are disproportionately the victim of rape. The average man can physically overpower the average woman. Arming the woman with a firearm gives her a force multiplier, something she can use to overpower the man. Taking this away from them means that women must rely on other people being around to prevent it, or on the police to prevent it. Seeing how rape has skyrocketed in recent years in Europe, and also in Japan, it's hard to conclude that the law can prevent rape. The US, of course, still has rape, and there's no number of rapes prevented by armed women. But once again, we're speaking logically here. An armed woman has a greater chance at preventing victimhood than an unarmed woman. The same thing can be applied to men. When the average man meets another, it's likely that the crime will occur in full. The property or life will be taken. When the man is armed, he can prevent himself from becoming the victim of a property crime or homicide, which men are disproportionately the victim of. Once again, armed innocent people have a better chance at protecting themselves than those who are not. I dare hearken back to those 800,000 plus defensive uses that the CDC reports. We've all dealt with the police at some point. And if you haven't, remain thankful. They are anything short of helpful. They show up 20 to 30 minutes after the crime or incident has occurred, jot down some notes, maybe take someone in, and little happens. Here's an anecdote, but don't let that disparage my point. I'm willing to bet millions can relate. One night, I was in my kitchen making ramen. Then boom, 6 to 8 pistol rounds were fired off at the gas station by my house. My grandfather calls the police, reports the problem. Nothing. They never show up, never ask questions, nothing at all. Not even a call back. Someone was just shot at, and they did nothing. That seriously shook my confidence in the service of the police. What if it were me getting shot at? They would have just never shown up. My attacker would have gotten away. Ludicrous. This is why I propose that armaments be available to the public. And they should not be limited. Having a bigger magazine is an advantage. Having a fully featured gun is an advantage. having the ability to get one with ease is an advantage. As rare as these incidents are, it's not impossible to be the victim of one. Crime happens. People are made victims of it. It's a reality. Being prepared for it and not being limited severely or even at all can give you an edge. Funnily, most gun control efforts have targeted features of guns rather than the guns themselves. In California, assault weapon laws have made certain cosmetics illegal to have in tandem. The NFA had made having a short barrel and a stock illegal. It made having a stock on your pistol illegal. It also made a shotgun with the same loading system as an 1800s revolver illegal. Yet a semi-automatic that is 100 times more effective and easier to use is perfectly legal. It's absurd. These laws don't do anything. They target innocent people because innocent people would be forward about the ownership of these guns. Here's a huge digression. Why are suppressors even illegal? Here's some quick facts. They only reduce the sound of a firearm minimally. A suppressed rifle will make the same noise a shotgun makes. A suppressed pistol will be loud as well. Even with suppressors, most guns aren't hearing safe. You have to run them with less ballistically effective bullets to even get them below 120 decibels. The quietest you can get them is 60 to 80 decibels under certain circumstances with specific ammo, guns, and accessories. It's insane. Suppressors increase the safety of the shooter 100% of the time and will not make them completely quiet. It's a gun, it's still loud. People will know when it's shot. Especially indoors, when most self-defense cases indoors take place, 90% of the time the shooter isn't wearing ear protection. This can lead to severe ear damage. This video is really starting to drag on, so I'll conclude. Gun control has been ineffective. It will remain ineffective. Statistically, it has not stopped violent crime anywhere when analyzing the trends. Logically, an armed populace can more readily protect itself and will increase economic activity. On that note, support the gun owners of America and the Firearms Policy Coalition. They fight gun control and protect your rights to keep and bear arms. Hey, I did a pro-gun video without mentioning the 2A. Crazy. This is Frost, signing out.